Good morning, Elgin Missionary Church, and welcome once again to Church Online. Thank you so much for joining us today. If it is your first time here with us, make sure to check out the information in the description below. It helps you get in contact with our church community, and you can learn more about the fantastic ministries going on at Elgin Missionary Church. We have another great service here online today, so let's get to it. But before we get started, please join me as I pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this day. Thank you for the weather. Thank you for just the community that we have here and the church family that you've provided. And just, Lord, help us be blessed by this service and bless others as we go into our lives, our workplaces, our social settings, our schools, everything, Lord. We just give it all over to you. In Jesus' amazing name I pray, and I'm not ashamed. Amen. Enjoy the service.
The hallelujah. Hey family, it's John, Matthew, and Kim. Just wanting to bring you a quick update on the latest happenings here. Excited to tell you that on Wednesday this week, we'll be hopping on a plane and heading to Bulgaria for 3 months. And excited to be doing the missions work that we've been eagerly awaiting for so long, just waiting for the open door from Jesus. So this is our very quick blast update on that.
So in the original plan, John Matthew is going to go in November, and the kids and I were going to join for a trip next year. But in the last couple of weeks, we have decided to join and to go for a longer time. So it's been a bit of a roller coaster the last week or so, trying to get ready. And it's been pretty amazing to see how Jesus has pulled the logistics together. Yeah. And also, we're trusting that these last couple days of getting ready are going to be fruitful and successful, so that Wednesday will be smooth flying, we hope.
Yeah, we're trusting Jesus. And really what we want to ask is that you would pray for us, that you would pray for God's protection, that you would pray for health for us, that you pray for God's provision and for finances, and that we would be fruitful in the mission that he's put in front of us. We want to take you with us. We want you to come with us on this journey that we're taking with Jesus. You're a huge blessing to us and an encouragement, and we need your prayers. And we get to do it together because we're family, and I love that. We love that. And so would you pray for us? And if you want to get updates on that sort of thing, you can check out the Facebook page for Worship With Us. It's Worship With Us Ministries. And if you're so inclined, you can even sign up for our newsletter. We send out regular email blasts, and you can sign up at johnmatthew.ca right there on the homepage. Thank you for loving us. Thanks for coming with us. We appreciate you, and we're looking forward to telling you stories about God's goodness when we get back. But please pray for us. We're getting out of here in 3 days, and it's going to be a good adventure. So bless you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
I just wanna speak. speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains. Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Let's sing once more, shout it out. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Your name
is your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is love. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to be able to come together today to share together in the Word of God and to spend some time in worship. And thank you for all of you that join. Particularly, I want to extend a greetings to those who do not make Elgin Missionary Church in Stratford your home church. You've somehow found us online and you've been part of our worship experience over these last few months, and good to see you. Here's a verse many of you have memorized, and we recall it, we bring it back to mind when we're worried about something or we're feeling overwhelmed. And that's the passage in the letter of Philippians, chapter 4, verses 6 to 7. And it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Now, this passage, as I said, is in the letter of Philippians. And if you were to go through the entire four chapters of the letter Philippians, you could come up with a word that would be well used to describe this entire letter, and that word would be joy. 16 times throughout the letter of Philippians, the word joy, or a derivative of that word, is used. And that's good news. Think about it for a minute. When discouragement or depression strikes, a symptom of those things is really the absence of joy. And Paul reaffirms for us that there is joy that comes through the Spirit of God as one of the fruit of the Spirit that's found actually in the book of Galatians. And there's also the joy that we have of knowing that the situations we face are being cared for, they're being held in the hands of our loving and almighty God. Now, the trouble's this. While we may acknowledge that joy is a fruit of the Holy Spirit and that God is definitely sovereign over the affairs of our lives, we also need to acknowledge that it has been tough going recently. Has anyone noticed that our experience of joy these days seems to be rather fleeting or perhaps even non-existent? The things that you used to do which brought pleasure or fulfillment, a sense of well-being or contentment, it feels as though those things just aren't as effective in producing those feelings of joy and well-being. It's just they're not working as well as they used to. How difficult it is to remain joyful, for there are so many things that would come against us to disturb our joy. And D. Martin Lloyd-Jones, a wonderful Anglican preacher, years gone by, called these things the tyranny of circumstances. The tyranny of circumstances. The things that happen to us. And yes, and I am talking about the pandemic. I am. I'm talking about some of the fear that has gripped so many in relation to the pandemic, and I'm talking about the absence of joy associated with these times that we've been going through. And yet, even as I believe that there's a modern-day example, illustration to what we're dealing with today, there's more to it than that. If you were to take away this pandemic and all the implications of it, we would still have what we describe as one of those days. And you know what I mean. And it's that day that starts off bad and then it gets worse. You wake up with a headache and you find out that during the night one of the pipes have burst in the basement and you call the plumber, only to find out that you will need to cash in an RRSP to cover the expense. You wash the car, and 15 minutes later it rains. Or you want to cut the grass, so you go out, you find your lawnmower won't start. You've planned an evening out, but just before you leave, one of your children come down with a fever, and then is sick to their stomach. And you know, oh, it's just one of those days. But then there are those other things, and those things really that go beyond, way beyond, one of those days. The doctor finds a lump. There's a tragedy in the family. You get a phone call. You find out that your teenage daughter is pregnant. You find out your son is on drugs. We've all had those things. It's fair to say that I've just described one of those storms, really, that we all endure at one time or another. It's a storm. Jesus refers to the storms of life at the end of Matthew chapter 7, and he describes two builders, one having heard the words of Jesus but ignored them. It's like a man who builds on sand, and the other man hears the words of Jesus but puts them into practice. He's like the man who builds on the rock. You may remember that story. It's fair to say that the storm, it tests out the quality and the vibrancy of your faith in Jesus Christ. Does your faith hold in the midst of the storm? You see, that's the test that counts. The storm comes, it pummels you, it knocks you around, you feel hurt, you feel the blows, and at the end of the day, you observe, well, I've lost a few shingles, there's a bit of water in the basement, but you know, the faith, my faith has stood the test, the house is still standing. You see, Paul likewise wants to encourage you in the midst of the storm. And he's writing under the influence of the Holy Spirit of God to these believers. And basically, he's helping them answer this question. How do you endure the storm, finding peace in the midst of challenging circumstances? And the first principle is quite easy. It comes directly from the text. And principle number one, it's be careful for nothing. That's the King James Version. The New International Version says, do not be anxious about anything. And he tells us that which we must avoid. He says, don't be anxious about anything. The word here, anxiety, anxious, is the same one which is used of Jesus' statement in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 25, where he tells the crowd, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food and the body more important than clothes? And literally what Jesus means, and I think what we find here in Philippians as well, it means do not be over anxious. Do not brood upon it. Do not meditate upon it. Do not let it become a fixation in your life. Because it's important for us to make the distinction between wise forethought and anxiety. Wise forethought means we give consideration of the future, but we do not live in fear of it. What anxiety does, it depletes our emotional tanks. We grow raw, we grow irritable, we get cranky. It affects our hearts and our minds. And when Paul mentions this in verse 7, he's really giving us an insight into how we are wired, humanly speaking. You see, while we can control many things in our lives, we find it exceedingly difficult to control our hearts and our minds. And we're given warnings throughout the scripture about the condition of our hearts and the conditions of our mind. And to justify this statement only requires that you remember any occasion where you've laid in bed, you're desperate for sleep, but you couldn't because your mind wouldn't let you. Your heart would not let you. You would almost give anything to quiet your heart and your mind, but they keep on going, thinking, pondering, keeping you awake. You toss and you turn. The heart that Paul speaks of here in Philippians is really, it really means the seat of one's emotions. The mind means the activity of thought. As an example, you have a great concern for someone you love, and in that concern and in your love, your mind kicks in with all sorts of thoughts, and you wonder, what if this should happen? What if that should happen? Or you're laying in bed and you think about the next day's events, something scheduled, your mind comes forth with all sorts of possibilities and responses. You go through the scenarios. If this takes place, I will need to do this. Or if it happens like that, these are the arrangements I need to make. You see, when we're in a state of anxiety, we become, in many ways, useless, paralyzed. In this state of anxiety, we spend an excessive amount of time reasoning and arguing and changing imagination, chasing imaginations. We go through all sorts of stuff. So how do you avoid this inner turmoil? What is the teaching of Scripture? Well, Paul goes on. He says, principle number 2, let your requests be made known to God. Now, we all know that this world has advice in dealing with anxiety. There is a way, though, that is specifically Christian. There is a psychological way of dealing with anxiety, and then there's the Christian way of dealing with anxiety. So how does Paul deal with it? How does Paul deal with anxiety? First, you should note that some of the things he doesn't say. The first thing he doesn't say is stop worrying. Many will say, use common sense, stop worrying. But this is indeed the very thing that those gripped with anxious thoughts cannot do. And not only that, to stop worrying, to somehow repress that worry, that anxiety, will bubble up in another place. It will cause many more, far more serious disorders, emotional, mental, physical. So Paul does not say stop worrying. He does not say stop worrying, it may never happen. Well, what if it does? It may happen. You see, that's the anxious person's thoughts. That's their response. You know, another thing he doesn't say, he says, you must not worry. It's wrong to worry. All the worry in the world will not make a difference. And we say, yes, that's true. It's common sense. But that does not make a difference to the one who's gripped with anxious thoughts. And why is that? It is because the anxiety has gripped the mind and the heart. It's those two areas over which we can exercise little control. We find very hard to influence. So what do you do? As a Christian, Paul's remedy, he says, let your requests be made known to God. Now, I know what some of you will say at this particular point. Some of you have been gripped with anxious thoughts, will say, I've been there, I've done that, it didn't work. And Paul must have realized that this would be the response of some people and has really given us specific instructions as to how to approach God in prayer in order that it does work, that it will alleviate that anxiety. The first thing he says is to pray, literally meaning worship and adoration. So the first thing we do is we spend time in worship. That's what that prayer means. That's what it means. That word for prayer means worship. Coming into the presence of God. Spending some time face to face with God. Pouring out your heart in adoration to God. Thinking of his love for you. Thinking of his infinite care. Thinking of all the times in the past that he has answered prayer. Thinking of his wisdom, his guidance, which comes beyond our understanding. Literally adoration. It doesn't start with your petition. Please note, we come first to worship, to remember who our God is. The second thing is then to bring that supplication or petition, it may say, the particular need. And then it says, bring your concern to God. Lay it before him. He desires to know the need of your heart. But even as you pray and as you lay that concern before God, there is one more thing that must be present in order for God to effectively deal with your anxiety, and that is thanksgiving. That whole prayer must be tempered with thanksgiving. It's essential. And one of the reasons is sometimes we pray with a grudge toward God. We may say, God, why is this happening to me? Why couldn't you have changed that situation for me? Why did you permit me to go through this? Why did you allow this? We have a grudge against God. And you know, if you have a grudge against God, it goes without saying, you'll not experience his peace. Your giving of thanks really centers itself around our understanding of the goodness of God. We may have troubles, we may have crises, we may have issues, but our response to God needs to be tempered with a note of thanks. So, what have I to give thanks for? In the midst of a situation that's creating anxiety for you, there's a lot of things to thank God for. The first is salvation. I've been saved through Jesus Christ. He sent his son, Jesus, died upon the cross for my sins, that I might be justified before God. I am cleansed. I am renewed daily, it says in your word, Lord. And that God loves us. The very hairs of our heads are numbered. You know, one of the things that I've been doing lately to remind myself of all of this, I've been singing a children's song that I learned when I was a child. It's a song that you might know. God sees the little sparrow fall, it meets his tender view. If God so loves the little bird, I know he loves me too. He loves me too, he loves me too, I know he loves me too. Because he loves the little things, I know he loves me too. I've been singing that in the car. I've been singing that in my devotions. I've been singing that a lot lately. There's other verses to it, but it really comes back to that refrain. He loves me too. He loves me too. I know he loves me too. Because he loves the little things, I know he loves me too. How important this is. You see, in order for Paul's remedy for anxiety to work, we must be in a right relationship with God. We must be able to worship our God with confidence, to lay our requests before him in petition, and through it all, to thank him for his grace, his abiding care, his provision, his protection. And that brings us then to the third principle, principle number three, and it says, "And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." Now, the first thing that you need to realize is that there is no mention in this promise of the situation which is actually bothering you. Pay attention. Paul does not say this. He doesn't say, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and God will remove all those things which are presently bothering and worrying you." That's not what Paul says. As a matter of fact, there is no mention anywhere in this passage of the actual circumstances that are causing the anxiety. You see, and this is the victory of the Christian life. Whatever our circumstances, whatever, we ourselves can be right and spiritually maintained before our God. This passage doesn't mention circumstances. They may or may not happen. We don't know. Paul does not say that the thing feared is not going to take place. What he does say is we shall be kept, whether it happens or whether it doesn't. And you see, God, this is the victory. This is where God comes, and this is the victory. I've been taken above my circumstances, and I am triumphant in spite of them. And so this is the essence of the third principle. Instead of being tyrannized by the circumstances of life, we're told that we're going to be kept in a state of peace in spite of them. Please keep this in mind. Prayer, as taught by Paul, is not like a panacea that makes us feel better. That's not really what prayer is for. It's not a replacement for bad thinking. It's not just to fill our minds with the things, the thoughts of God, and in so doing, we push out those other things. And we recognize this. Paul tells us, throughout the scriptures, it tells us that prayer does change things. It does. Prayer has an effect. It moves the hand of God. But that's really not what Paul is saying here. What Paul is saying here is that you pray, make your request to God. God will do something. He will guard you with peace, your hearts and your minds. It may very well be that he will even take the circumstances in which you're experiencing and he will turn them to your benefit and your favor. But most importantly, he will guard you in the process. The word here for guard is to keep or to garrison about. What that literally means is God places a fortress around about you. He himself keeps watch over you as you stay there, remain there in perfect peace. And then he tells us that this peace transcends all understanding. You know, and I can understand that too. When people look at you and you're experiencing some very difficult things, challenges in life, and yet you exhibit the peace of God, both in mind and heart, and people say, how do you do that? How does that happen? And you cannot imagine it. You cannot understand how it could be, given the circumstances. Yet in the midst of it, there is a peace of God in Jesus Christ that is affecting your soul. It's a peace We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's found in the book of Romans. It is a peace that comes from our God. There's no natural way of explaining it, except to say that God, He did this. I believe in prayer. I believe in the power of prayer, and I believe that when we do pray, God changes things, but He also changes us. And the secret to joy in the Christian walk is not avoidance of all the areas of pain. It is not the prayers of desperation that God would somehow remove the circumstances we find ourselves in. He may. I don't ever want to tear that hope away from anyone. Rather, the secret to joy is found first in the command of Scripture. All you need to do is look up a little bit farther in the book of Philippians in chapter 4 and verse 4. It is a command, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Paul says it's not just a choice we make, it's a command of God. Rejoice in the Lord always. And then in the promise of God, that when we pray, we worship Him and we thank Him and we bring to Him the concerns of our hearts and our minds. And in the midst of that, as we do these things, as it's been described here this morning, He will bring a peace that transcends all understanding and that will guard your heart and your mind in the day of adversity. So there's a few questions I want to leave with you this morning as we conclude. The first one is this. What circumstances of life are presently attempting to tyrannize you, causing you excessive worry? You know, we've all been subject to those bad days when it seems that everything goes wrong. If you're human and breathing, you've had those days. Remember the promise of God. Now, I won't guarantee that your day will get any better. It might. Wouldn't that be awesome? But I will guarantee that as you submit yourself to Him, praying these things through, you will experience peace in the midst of it. Have you been finding it hard to sleep at night? I would suggest instead of counting sheep, go to the shepherd. Go to the shepherd. Reflect on His love for you. Tell Him how much you love Him back. Reflect upon this, that his sovereign will has kept you till this very moment and that He will continue to be there for you. Remembering then the promises of God and then bringing these concerns to Him and saying, God, these are yours, that I leave them here with you. You see, one thing we don't remember, we should remember, but we don't, is that Paul was in prison when he wrote these words. He didn't know what the next day was going to bring, but he wrote them anyway. Rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Do not be tyrannized by the circumstances of life. Pray, worship, thank God for His abundant love for you. And then experience His direct touch. He doesn't ask you to repress your anxiety. He asks you to release it to Him. And He brings peace to your heart as an exchange. Let's pray together. Father, this morning, I give you thanks that these words, Lord, are from your word. And the things of God can be very real to us. And I trust, Lord, today that if there's anyone here who says, I have been going through some deep waters, and I have been up at night, I've been struggling somewhat with my thoughts and my heart, I have been facing some discouragements and depression. Today, Lord, I ask that that all would change. I come back to you and I praise you for your goodness and your grace. I thank you, Lord, for how you've taken notice of me. I thank you, Lord, today that that concern that has been keeping me up at night, God, you're fully aware of, and it's yours. It's something, Lord, that you will take care of, and I can leave it with you. I also know, Lord, today that your Spirit comes. And I thank you, Lord, today. I don't hold a grudge against you regarding the situation. I just thank you, Father, that you're walking me with me through this time. And I bless you. May the fruit of peace, may the fruit of being guarded in my mind and my heart be my reality right now. And I leave that with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
When your heart is anything but quiet and peace feels a million miles away, when the world is heavy on your shoulders and you don't know the path that you should take, when you cry out to the Lord and your broken voice is weak, when you can't stand anymore, He'll meet you on your knees. Be still and know you don't have to worry. Be still and know He'll find you where you are. He is good. His love will never let you go. Trust Him. Be still and know. Be still and know. His plan is for the good of all who love Him. His word is a promise you can hold. So cry out to the Lord. He is strong when you are weak. Find rest and be restored. He is all you need. Be still and know you don't have to worry. Be still and know He'll find you where you are.
Still.